So, good evening, everyone. Just wait a second. Okay, so I hope I'm visible and audible to all of you. Please give me a thumbs up. So hello Vikas, how are you? So today I will discuss about the last movement notes for dermatology, and this is with respect to the histopathology, the most important images or the appearance which you should know before going for your exam. So, good evening everyone. Just a brief introduction of myself. I'm Dr. Cheshta Agarwal, dermatology educator on An Academy, that is India's largest online platform for NEET PG preparation. And I'm myself a All India Rank 261 holder. So, I'll tell you the tips and tricks which I've used, especially with respect to the dermatology. So, today the last look notes in dermatology, it mainly includes the important point with respect to the histopathology. And side by side, I will also tell you about the other important questions which you may get with respect to that particular topic. Now, before going ahead, just few information about the courses on An Academy. So, I am conducting a course on dermatology through case series. And the course has already started from 13th July. So, I want all of you to please enroll into my course. If you have got the An Academy subscription, you can directly go and enroll into the course. But if you have not yet subscribed to An Academy, please subscribe to An Academy. Use my referral code Cheshta10 for the subscription. Okay. The next is, there is one more course going on An Academy, that is the crash course for the FMG students. As we know that the FMG exam is coming on this August only. So we have started a crash course. This course mainly includes the high yield topics as well as the related MCQs. So this is a very nice course for those preparing for the FMG this year, that is August. So please join this course, use my referral code, that is Cheshta10, for the enrollment or the subscription of An Academy. You will get additional 10% discount. So I hope you all are with me. Many students have joined. So we'll start with today's class. Now first, so we will discuss about the important appearance which you will get in the exam. So first is the camel foot appearance, which is seen in case of psoriasis. What is psoriasis? It is a papulosquamous disorder. Very important, we have already read about the histopathological changes of the psoriasis, that is the papulosquamous disorder. And here the most important change which happens is there is increase in the thickness of the skin. There is hyperkeratosis as well as there is papillomatosis. It means that dermal papillas have increased in size and number. So because of this papillomatosis and increase in the size of the reader ridges, you can see this type of appearance, and this will resemble the foot of the camel, very characteristic of psoriasis. Other than that, a very important characteristic is presence of nucleus in this, that is parakeratosis. Presence of nucleus in the layer of the stratum corneum, which is called as parakeratosis. So this is first very important discussion of today, that is the psoriasis, which is called as the camel foot appearance. Now next is the clinical feature, little bit about the clinical feature of psoriasis. So here you have what is called as well-defined lesions. First important point is well-defined. Second is salmon color or red color plaque. Third is presence of silvery scales or micaceous scales. So you can see that there is very well defined plaque with superficial silvery micaceous scale. And fourth is presence of hypopigmented surrounding, which is called as Voronoff's ring. And this Voronoff's ring is because of PGE2. Decrease in the level of prostaglandin E2. So these are the points which is must for your psoriasis. And the histopathology, I have told you, very important point is presence of parakeratosis, hypo or agranulosis and presence of papillomatosis as well as proliferation of retail ridges. I hope this is clear to all of you. Going towards the second important or the last movement note, that is the chicken wire or the fishnet pattern. It is seen in case of the direct immunofluorescence. So it is an immunofluorescence finding in case of the pemphigus. You can see that there is deposition of the antibodies on the margins of the cells of the stratum spinosum, and this resembles something like a chicken wire or a fishnet appearance. So I hope this is clear to all of you. Very important with respect to pemphigus vulgaris. And in case of pemphigus vulgaris, you have antibodies seen against the desmoglein 3 as well as desmoglein 1. So desmoglein 3 antibodies are more and desmoglein 1 antibodies are less in pemphigus vulgaris. And these antibodies are present in between the cells of stratum spinosum, and hence you can see the presence of this type of immunofluorescence study. So I hope this point is also clear to you. Please give me a thumbs up. Now this is the classical clinical feature of pemphigus vulgaris. Can you tell me what is the classical bullae in case of pemphigus vulgaris? So the classical bullae in pemphigus vulgaris, they are flaccid. And this is because the split here is intraepidermal. So these two points are very, very important with respect to pemphigus vulgaris, that is presence of flaccid bullae which are intraepidermal in location. The next important point is intraoral or oral lesions. So mucosal involvement is very common in case of pemphigus vulgaris, and it is seen that the mucosal lesions can be the only presentation in case of pemphigus. So whenever you get a patient with recalcitrant oral lesions and which are not getting treated with the normal therapies, then always think about the pemphigus. So oral lesions which are more common, mucosal lesions which are more common in the oral cavity, but other mucosas, for example the genital mucosas or the nasal mucosas, can also be involved. The third important feature is on the histopathology, we see intraepidermal acantholysis, intraepidermal split, and there is presence of something called as intact stratum basale layer, which is called as a row of tombstone. So these are some of the important points or the last moment notes which is required for the pemphigus. And what is the treatment of choice? It is the steroids. So you have to give intralesional steroid in these cases, which is very important for the treatment. So I hope this point is clear to all of you. Please give me a thumbs up. Vikas, Cheena, Gaurav and Ankit, please give me a thumbs up if you understood this very important point. Going towards the next important point, that is the church spire appearance. Now what is church spire appearance? This is this part, that is the topmost part of the church, is called as church spire. And can you see the similar pattern here also? So this type of appearance is seen in case of seborrheic keratosis. Very, very important. Seborrheic keratosis is also called as seborrheic wart. So please, whenever you get in the question that there is a seborrheic wart and the causative etiology is, whether it is a viral wart, it is a bacterial wart. So the answer is, it is a pre-malignant condition or a proliferation of the stratum corneum. It is not a viral infection. So seborrheic keratosis is also called as seborrheic wart, but that is a misnomer. And the histopathological appearance is church spire appearance, and this is because of proliferation of the stratum corneum. Can you see the clinical feature here? So this is the back of a patient. You can see multiple seborrheic keratosis, and this is the focus of a single lesion, and they give you a characteristic stuck-on appearance. Stuck-on appearance means as if it is stuck to the skin. It means that as if because of some glue you have attached it to the skin, which is called as the stuck-on appearance. Now can you tell me anyone what is Lesser Trillate sign? Any one of you, what is Lesser Trillate sign? Any one of you? So what is Lesser Trillate sign? Whenever there is sudden increase in the SK, that is seborrheic keratotic lesions over the body, it indicates that there is some internal malignancy which has developed. So this is called as leisure trillate sign, a very important sign with respect to seborrheic keratosis. And another is the stuck-on appearance, which is the characteristic clinical sign of the seborrheic keratosis. And this is also called as seborrheic wart. So please don't get confused that this is not a viral infection. This is not a viral wart. Instead, it is this type of proliferation of the stratum corneum as well as the upper epidermis. So I hope this is clear to all of you. Please give me a thumbs up. What is the stuck-on appearance of seborrheic keratosis? Please give me a thumbs up, all of you. Very important last movement note. Okay. Now starting with the another part, that is the clutch claw in the ball. So this is the characteristic histopathological appearance of lichen nitidus. And what is this clutch claw? So can you see this small inflammatory infiltrate which is present just below the epidermis? So these form a collection and the surrounding retae, it will cover the margins of the inflammatory infiltrate, something like clutching a ball in the hand. So this type of appearance is called as the clutch claw ball appearance or claw clutching ball appearance, very characteristic of lichen nitidus. Now what is lichen nitidus? It is a disease which occurs especially in the younger individual, that is in case of younger children, where you develop multiple small sized skin colored, can you see skin colored papular lesions which are usually skin colored and they are asymptomatic. So they are skin colored papules which are usually asymptomatic and they are mainly present over the extremities, that is upper extremity as well as the penile shaft. So this is the common site where it is present. The pathology and the etiology is very similar to lichen planus, but this is not exactly what lichen planus is. So that is why it is called as lichen nitidus. So this is completely different and the histopathological image is something called as claw clutching in the hand appearance. So I hope this is clear to you. That is the lichen nitidus, which has similar monomorphic papules present over the extensor surface. Now going towards the next slide, that is trichoepithelioma, and here you get this type of cribriform appearance. So can you see this is because of the proliferation of, that is the proliferation of the sebaceous gland, you can see that the presence of the trichoepithelioma. Now this is the clinical feature where you can see this type of skin colored appearance. So you can have skin colored papules which are mainly present over the nasolabial fold. So this is the classical site of this trichoepitheliomas. In few cases it is present over the bridge of the nose also. But if you see similar type of lesion just below and around the eyes, then the example will become syringomas. So it is very different from the trichoepitheliomas, which are a sebaceous gland proliferation, and it usually occurs in those who have a genetic predisposition for the development of enlargement of these glands. So very classical, that is trichoepithelioma. And what is the characteristic histopathological appearance? It is called as the cribriform appearance, which is somewhat like this, like a net or a what is called in Hindi, that is channi. So it is somewhat like a cribriform or a net appearance, which is called as trichoepithelioma. So I hope this is clear to all of you. Please give me a thumbs up so that I can go ahead for the next slide. Please give me a thumbs up if this is clear to all of you. Okay. Now coming to the next part, that is called as the dilapidated bricks appearance. So what is dilapidated brick? It is somewhat like this, which is seen in the old house. And this is appearance which is seen in case of Hailey-Hailey disease. Can you see this? And this appearance is because of something called as intraepidermal acantholysis. So that is intraepidermal acantholysis, which is very characteristic of Hailey-Hailey disease. And what is the reason behind the intraepidermal acantholysis? This is because of the calcium channel defect. This calcium channel defects lead to abnormal function of desmoglein. There is abnormal function of desmoglein and hence there is this type of intraepidermal cleft or acantholysis, which is very similar to the pemphigus vulgaris, but here we do not have any antibodies. Mere calcium channel defect causes functional abnormality of the desmoglein. Now the question asked, this is the clinical feature. You can see that there is this type of erosions which are present on the flexural areas, and there is almost always there is presence of positive family history. So this is very important point. You should know that there is presence of positive family history in case of Hailey Hailey disease. Now the questions related to Hailey Hailey disease is the gene. Can you tell me which is the gene affected in case of Hailey Hailey disease? Any one of you? The gene affected is ATP2C1. Very important question. And similar to this, you have a gene which is called as ATP2A2, which is seen in case of Dyer's disease. I hope this is clear to you. So ATP2C1 is related to Hailey Hailey disease, which presents with this type of clinical feature, that is erosions mainly over the flexural areas, for example in case of axilla, below the breast, as well as in the groin. So these are the site where you can see presence of this type of erosions, and on clinical feature you will see the presence of dilapidated brick appearance. So I hope this is clear to all of you, and a very important point with respect to your exam, you can get this type of clinical feature in your exam. Now going towards the next slide, that is festooned papillae appearance. Now what is festooning? So do you ever go to a party and see these type of appearance? This is usually used for the decoration in the parties. So this type of festooning is seen in case of porphyrias. Now can you see this appearance? You can see this type of papilla, that is the festooning, which is seen here. So this type of festooning is very similar, and it is seen in case of porphyria, where you have the pathology which is present just below the dermis, that is at the level of dermo-epidermal junction. Now the questions related to porphyrias are, how does it look clinically and what are the porphyrias? So these are the defect in the heme synthesis. Now defect in heme synthesis will lead to accumulation of porphyrin, and these porphyrins, they are phototoxic. It means that in the presence of a particular wavelength, that is 608 wavelength, it causes harmful effect to the skin. And what does the clinically feature it present? It presents with multiple blisters, erosions, as well as scarring, which is present over the exposed, sun exposed areas. So this is the classical clinical feature of porphyria, and the most common porphyria which we are talking about is porphyria cutanea tarda, congenital erythropoietic porphyria. In both of these you can see these type of clinical feature, that is blister, erosion and scarring. Now a very important question which is usually asked with respect to porphyria is, there is another form of porphyria which is called as erythropoietic protoporphyria. It never presents with blistering, and it presents with burning sensation and erythema. So this is a very important difference between the porphyria cutanea tarda, that is this one, and the congenital erythropoietic porphyria. Among these two and this erythropoietic protoporphyria, in EPP you will never get intact bullet. Instead you will have presence of burning sensation, as well as you will have presence of erythema. So please note, this is a very important point, and give me thumbs up if you understood this important point with respect to the upcoming porphyrias. Please give me a thumbs up. Now the next feature is something called as the flame thrower like appearance. Now what is flame thrower like appearance? Can you tell me, any one of you, what is flame thrower's like appearance? So flame thrower appearance, it is seen in the vertical section of the telogen hair. So can you see, this is the vertical section or the longitudinal section, any one of you? So this is the longitudinal section of the telogen hair, and it will give you an appearance of the flamethrower, somewhat like this. So this is the normal histology of the vertical section of the hair. Vertical section of the hair. So nothing to show here. This is just an example of the vertical section which shows the presence of the flamethrower appearance. So please give me a thumbs up if you understood. Am I audible and visible to you? Please give me a thumbs up if I am audible and visible to you. Am I audible and visible? So I hope I am audible and visible to all of you. So now proceeding to the next part, that is the fried egg appearance, which is seen in case of mastocytosis. Now these are the mast cells which give you an appearance of the fried egg. Can you see, this is the central part is somewhat like this, and this irregular margin is giving a fried egg appearance, which is very characteristic of mastocytosis. Okay, so that is the fried egg appearance. Now clinical feature of the mastocytosis, it can present with urticaria pigmentosa like features. And what is urticaria pigmentosa? Mainly seen in younger individual which present with this type of well defined erythematous to hyperpigmented macules. Pigmented macules. Okay, so if you look at this picture, you can see there is erythematous papule and there is erythematous macule which is seen here. Now on rubbing it, there is increase in the redness as well as there is increase in itching. Okay, this increase in redness and increase in itching is called as the Dayrier sign. So this is also one of the question which is frequently asked, that is the Dayrier sign is seen in which disorder. So it is seen in case of urticaria pigmentosa. I hope this is very clear to you. Urticaria pigmentosa, very commonly seen in case of infant, and on rubbing it there is increase in the erythema as well as there is increase in the itching. Very classical of urticaria pigmentosa. Now going towards the next last movement point, that is the onion skin appearance, which is seen in case of borderline leprosy. So this is very important. Can anybody tell me which type or which variant of borderline leprosy present with onion skin appearance? Any one of you? Very important exam question. The borderline leprosy, that is borderline lepromatous leprosy. Borderline lepromatous leprosy will present with this type of onion skin, and this is because of the proliferation of perineurium, that is the perineurium of the nerve. And because of this proliferation of the perineurium, you can see that multiple concentric circles are present around the nerve, and which is very classical of borderline lepromatous leprosy. Now see, leprosy, it is a very important part with respect to your exam. You will get questions on histopathology as well as clinical feature. There are few other histopathological images and points. For example, what is the Gren zone? Frequently asked. Now Gren zone, it is seen in case of lepromatous leprosy. And what is it? It is an area which is a free area or a homogeneous area which is present just below the epidermis, that is at the dermo-epidermal junction, only seen in case of lepromatous leprosy. Another point is the type of granulomas which is seen in case of lepromatous leprosy as well as tuberculoid leprosy. So in tuberculoid leprosy, you see something called as epithelioid granuloma. So this is also very important, that epithelioid granuloma is seen in case of tuberculoid pole, while in case of lepromatous leprosy, you will see something called as the macrophage granuloma. So this is very important. The macrophage granuloma is seen at the lepromatous pole. So they can ask you a question. Also in lepromatous pole, you see something called as foam cell. And what are foam cells? These are the macrophages which have engulfed the bacilli, that is Mycobacterium bacilli. And Mycobacterium leprae, it has large number of fat content in its wall, and that is why it give a foamy appearance to the skin. So the foam cells or Virchow cells are seen in the Lepromatous leprosy, where you have macrophage granulomas. So I hope this is clear to all of you. Please give me a thumbs up. These are some of the points which they can ask you frequently in your exam. Now next is the owl's eye appearance, which is seen in case of Verruca plana. And what is Verruca plana? It is a viral infection which occurs secondary to human papilloma virus. It is because of human papilloma virus, that is HPV. Now what is owl's eye appearance? That is the coelocyte, that is the intracellular edema, which leads to ballooning of the cells of the stratum spinosum. Ballooning of cell of stratum spinosum. So what happens, instead of the normal polygonal shape of the stratum spinosum, they become round shape. And the presence of round shape of the cell with central nucleus will give you an appearance which is called as the owl's eye appearance. So I hope this is clear. A very important exam question. They can ask you this type of questions in your exam. So owl's eye appearance, it is seen in case of Verruca plana, which is a human papilloma viral infection, that is HPV infection. And it is mainly HPV type 1 which causes this type of Verruca plana. And you can see these are the coelocyte which has increased in the intracellular edema, leading to the ballooning of the cell. Very important with respect to your exam. Now this is the clinical feature. This is Verruca plana. And on the right side you have something called as Verruca vulgaris. I hope this is clear to all of you. This one is Verruca vulgaris and this one is Verruca plana. Now as the name suggests, plana means flat lesions, while vulgaris means the most common variety. So Verruca vulgaris is the most common variety, which present with this type of rough or papilly surface on the surface. Okay, so these are some of the characteristics, and they can ask you the variant. So HPV 1 and 3 is most common cause of the Verruca plana, whereas HPV 2 is a most common cause for the Verruca vulgaris, which is the clinical presentation, which is the most common type. So I hope this point is clear to all of you. Now coming toward the next point, that is the palisading appearance. Now what is palisade? This is this type of, you can see in the old grounds or in the old fields, this is the wooden wall are used to demarcate the area between the two fields where the farmers grow their crop. So this palisading appearance is seen in case of basal cell carcinoma. And can you see this type cells? These are the cells of stratum basale which are present in the margin, and they form a characteristic palisading appearance like this. So this is called as palisading appearance, very characteristic of the basal cell carcinoma. Now how does the basal cell carcinoma presents clinically? So this is the classical presentation, and this is called as the rodent ulcer. So what is rodent ulcer? These are slow growing, locally invasive. Malignancy of the skin. And they are very characteristically, the most common site is, if this is the face of a patient, these are the eyes, this is the nose, and this is the mouth. So if you make a line from this part or this part, that is angle of mouth or the angle of the nose, and you mark it like this, so the area which is present above, that is the most common site for development of basal cell carcinoma. So I hope this point is clear to all of you, a very important point with respect to your exam. You will get a question that which is the most common site. So if you draw a line from the angle of the mouth or from the angle of the nose, and you extend that line up to the this part of the ear, that is the concha of the ear, the part which is present above, it is the most common site for the development of the basal cell carcinoma. The next is the picket fence appearance, that is somewhat like this. This is also seen surrounding the gardens. And this is very characteristic of dermatitis herpetiformis, that is the DIF, direct immunofluorescence finding. So if you see this bluish coloration, that is because of the deposition of IgA antibodies over the dermal papillae. Okay, so this is very characteristic, that deposition of granular deposition of IgA over the dermal papillae, which is very characteristic of dermatitis herpetiformis, seen specially in case of the direct immunofluorescence study. So I hope this point is clear to all of you. This is very important last moment note. Okay, now coming towards the next, that is the safety pin appearance, which is seen in case of donovanosis. It is seen in case of donovanosis and it is seen on GIMSA stain. Now can you see this type of safety pin appearance? So these are the intracellular bodies, which is seen inside the macrophages, and they are also called as, along with safety pin, they are also called as telephone handle. Okay, so this is very important, that is the telephone handle appearance or the safety pin appearance. Both of them are similar to each other and they are seen in donovanosis. And what is donovanosis? It is also called as the, it is secondary to granuloma inguinale. I think you cannot see here. So it is granuloma inguinale, which is one of the differential of the, it is a sexually transmitted disease and it presents as a differential of genital ulcer. Here you will see characteristic red beefy granulation tissue of the ulcer, and here you have no lymphadenopathy. There is no lymphadenopathy, so it is called as pseudobubo. That is, the enlargement is because of the secondary inflammation, so it is called as pseudobubo because there is no actual lymphadenopathy and the organism is Kellymetobacteria granulomatosis, which causes granuloma inguinale. So these are some of the important points with respect to the donovanosis. Coming to the next part, that is the sawtooth appearance. This is again a histopathological appearance which is seen in case of lichen planus. So you can see that it is looking like a tooth of the saw. So this is the retae which is looking like the tooth of the saw. So this is because of the, this is seen in case of lichen planus, very characteristic. And this is the clinical feature of lichen planus, which presents with 5 P's, that is presence of papule, which are pruritic, which are polygonal. They are purple in color and they are plain topped. And nowadays there are 2 more P's which is used, that is presence of pterygium, and the papule can lead to formation of plaque. So there are 5 or we can say 7 P's in case of lichen planus. That is the clinical feature. And there is one more entity which is called as the Wickham's triad. This is also seen on the, can you see this whitish lacy appearance? So that is the Wickham's triad, which is seen in the clinical lesions of the lichen planus. This is the next feature is the reveled wool appearance, which is seen in case of pseudoxanthoma elasticum. That is the defect in the elastic fiber. So there is defect in elastic fiber and it is somewhat like a reveled wool appearance. That is, you have put the wool and not properly arranged. And this is the classical clinical feature, which is called as the Moroccan's leather. Moroccan's leather appearance. Or it is also called as chicken skin appearance, which is very characteristic of the pseudoxanthoma elasticum. And in eye, you see something called as angioid streak. This is also a very important finding in the eyes, that is the ocular finding. So I hope this is clear to you. And I think this is the last slide for the today, that is the septate potato appearance, which is seen in case of molluscum. So can you see this? That is the central part of the molluscum and you can see these septates. So that is, they are rupturing towards the outer part and all the molluscum bodies are coming towards the top. And this will give you an appearance of a septate tomato. Very characteristic of molluscum contagiosa. It is a viral infection which occurs secondary to molluscum contagiosum virus. And the bodies which is visible here is called as Henderson-Peterson bodies. So very characteristic. And the clinical feature is they will form a pearly shiny papule with central umbilication. So very classical of the molluscum contagiosum. So I hope this is clear to all of you. And this is just a histopathological image of Pampicus vulgaris, which show you the intact lower part, that is the intact stratum basale, which give you a row of tombstone appearance, very classical of Pampicus vulgaris. So I am done with the today's session. So I hope you like the last moment session of dermatology. So if you like it, please subscribe to Unacademy. Use my referral code CHESTA10 for Unacademy subscription. And you can also use or also join me on my Telegram group. The name is Dermatology by Dr. Cheshta. So please join my Telegram group and please take an Unacademy subscription. You can try with 1 month subscription, and if you like it, you can extend it to 6 months or 3 months or 12 months. Use my referral code CHESTA10. So good night, take care, and study hard. We'll meet you soon with another session of last moment notes. Till then, I think we should stop our class now. So, okay, good night, take care, bye-bye.